Broadcasting from the business capital of the world, this is the Podcast Business News Network.
Hey, welcome back. We've talked about this before, managing stress and things you can do to alleviate some of that, bring it down a little bit. Today, it's one thing, one super simple thing that sometimes we don't realize the value of doing this in cutting the amount of stress that you have, and that is scheduling and being organized in that regard. So we're going to dig into that and more with Dr. Melissa Oden. She's the founding CEO of Health Education Resources Network, and she's amazing, and she's back with us. How are you doing there, Melissa?
I'm good. Happy Thanksgiving week.
Happy Thanksgiving week. That's one thing we don't have to schedule because Thursday, we know what it is. It's already, it's a pure schedule.
I know what time I'm eating. I know what time the Dallas Cowboys are playing. I got all that down. Not to worry on Thursday.
Are you telling me that you put that in a schedule?
Well, maybe.
Okay. Well, do you know what? That's how important it is. And, you know, this is not about me, but I'm gonna say this. I used to be just too anal retentive, think about things, schedule things. I got away from some of that and not, you know, trying to rely on this in terms of scheduling things. And I found that it just brought more stress. So I'm going back to making sure that everything is there, scheduled, planned out. It does make a huge difference, doesn't it?
Yeah, it really does. And if anyone is relying on the old noggin to make sure that stuff gets done, I'm telling you, you're setting yourself up for failure. It's just too much. We have too much going on in this crazy busy world of ours to rely on the brain. And the brain is a wonderful, wonderful organ. It really, really is. But when you're relying on that to make sure that you get stuff done, I'm telling you, you're gonna forget a kid. You're gonna forget the cat food at the store. You're wandering up and down the aisles, right? Like we've already established that we know we do. So you gotta have that list, right? So those things need to be written down somewhere so that you can kind of see what's happening and get kind of the bigger picture of what's going on.
I never wanted to be that person that every time they whip out their phone. Yeah, hold on. Let me get that down there. Let me put that down. Thursday? Yeah, let me put that down. I want to be that person now. I got to go back to doing that because what's going on now isn't working. It's just bringing on stress and even more stress when you forget something. And even more stress when you put something in, meet with Melissa Friday at 4:15, and then you don't put the location in or the address on your calendar because you're thinking, I'll get to that later. I'm busy over here. Well, guess what? Now I have to do a search and an email. Now I have to find the address. If you put it in the first time and get done with it, it's going to be so much easier.
Yes. And there's a saying, and I believe I'm going to attribute this to the U.S. Army, which, by the way, I was an Air Force brat. I'm just saying the Army has this good saying, and that is if you have time to do it right the second time, you had time to do it right the first time, right? If you have time to do it again the second time, you have time to do it right the first time. So, you know, you might think that you're spending a whole lot of time doing it correctly the first time, but I promise you, you're going to be wasting a whole lot more time and causing yourself a heck of a lot more stress if you're not focused on that time that you're spending that first time. Does that make sense?
Oh, Melissa, crystal clear. It's crystal clear. And that even goes back to the point I said before. If you're going to put it in your calendar, put it in completely. And I try to cheat the system by not being specific. Like I'll type in Melissa meeting. No, Melissa meeting about scheduling or whatever it is, just so it's there. You got to get in the habit. It's all about habits, getting in the habit.
Yeah. I can't tell you how many times I've met with students or even colleagues. And I'm like, okay, why are we meeting today? Like I had you on the schedule, but I didn't write down why we were meeting because I thought I would remember it. And by the time I get to that meeting a week later, I'm like, why were we meeting? Is this even necessary now? So it's really, really important to do that. Yeah.
So you seem very detail oriented. The scheduling thing is working for you. So give us some tips. Love to like pick your brain on that.
So let me just say up front, this happens to be one of my spiritual gifts is administration. And within that is organization. So I know a lot of people are like, I'm just not organized, whatever. This is a skill that you can learn, right? This is not beyond your reach to learn how to become organized and learn how to manage your time. And if this doesn't convict you, I don't know what will, but time is the only asset that we have that we cannot replace. You know, the words that are coming out of my mouth right now, those are going into the past as we speak. I can't bring those back. We're done. We're on to the next thing already. And, you know, when you think about how short life is and the brevity of life, it really kind of convicts you that I really need to kind of really grab onto this idea of let's manage my time a little bit better so that I am not wasting it, because I will not get it back. And, you know, so a lot of people are like, you know, I'd just rather fly by the seat of my pants. No. You're losing and wasting a lot of time when you do that. So I will say I've been using this particular system that I'm going to mention here for 30 years. I started when I was two.
Wow.
So it's just become a part of me. And I think that when you finally get into the habit of doing these things, it doesn't feel like such a burden anymore. And I'll just give a shout out to a coach that I have worked with in the past. Her name is Megan Sumrall. This video is not sponsored, by the way. But she has a saying, and she says that structure creates freedom. And I 100% agree with her that structure creates freedom. It is not a burden. It creates absolute freedom. So basically what I'm going to suggest, I'm just going to hold this up. I don't know. Can we see this? We can
see this. Yeah, totally. Okay. Clear.
So this is a weekly routine sheet that I have created. And I'll tell you just a little bit more about this in just a second. But where you can get one is what I mean. But this, and I'll just, for the people that may not be actually watching, let me just describe this really quickly. It is a sheet of paper landscape. It says weekly routine on it, and it starts at 5 a.m. and it goes to 11 at night. So I included all of you freakish people that like to stay up, like to get up in the morning. I am not a morning person at all. I am more of a night owl. So we start at 5 a.m. for those of you who like to start early. We end at 11 o'clock at night. And basically it is a week in your life. It is this huge overview so that you can see exactly what's going on at any given time of the day. And what I do is I just plug in everything that needs to be done that week, and I color code it. I know we're getting really down in the weeds, aren't we? But I color code it because I want to see how balanced is everything. So for example, I use blue as personal time. I use green as work time. I use purple as church time. So as I'm filling in all these different colors, I want to see, is there too much of one color there? Is there too much work time there? Is there too much green going on there? Right. So that way I can literally see how I'm spending my time during the week, and I can pull back and go, okay, maybe I need to spend a little less time working and maybe a little bit more blue time, which is personal and family time. Or maybe I need to spend a little more time working out or whatever the case may be. So this is how I have done it for, I'm not kidding you, 30 years. I actually got this from a direct sales company that I started my entrepreneurial journey with back when I was 21 years old. And I just kind of adapted it for what I need now. But it works like a charm, because what you can see, you can literally see your entire week at a glance on this one sheet of paper, and you can go, you know what? I need to change this. I don't have time to say yes to this, and I probably need to say no to that. So it really just is a tool that you can use to help start to organize your weeks, and then you can extract what you need to out of that for your days, if that makes sense.
100%. So questions here.
Yes.
That is a, you know, it's a sheet of paper. Mm-hmm. Are you using any online calendars, or do you rely on what you got there?
I do not. I'm very old school in that regard. In fact, I still carry a paper planner because I find that my brain just doesn't work that way. I just find that things fall through the cracks for me when I try to go electronically. So I keep it paper. But I will say this for those of you who aren't paper people, this can work too. It can work too. And I'm not sure what kind of calendar management systems people use and whether or not you can use that color coding process. I don't know. Steve, do you use one by any chance?
Simple Google Calendar. You can share it with other people. In terms of the color, you can create different calendars and they show up with a different color. So it could be Melissa Personal. It could be Melissa Business. It could be Melissa Meetings. And each calendar that you create, it'll show up in the same calendar, but it's a different category. So you can color code it in that regard.
Now see, there you go. I do use Google Calendar just to hold meetings and things like that, but I've never actually got, because my brain just does not work that way. So here's what I would say to everyone out there. You got to do what your brain how your brain works. You have to do what works for you in terms of not letting things fall through the cracks and being comfortable with the system that you're using. So while this does cater more to paper people, you can actually translate that into electronic planning. I will say this, the literature is pretty clear that when you actually write things down, when you go old school and use paper and pencil, the brain files that away very differently, and it uses it very differently and more efficiently than all the electronic stuff. And that's because when you use electronic equipment, it triggers a different part of the brain. I'm not a brain surgeon. I couldn't tell you exactly how that works. What I know is just what I read. And that is, you're using different parts of your brain when you do that. And for whatever reason, the paper and pencil method is always the best. So if you can use that, I would recommend it. But if you don't, then use what you're comfortable with.
Well, interesting you should say that, because research has been done that shows the connection between the mind, the eye, the hands. You retain it so much more,
yes,
as opposed to typing it. So there is a big benefit. The only negative is now you have to carry along something. And yeah, it's not as portable. If you're in a meeting, I left my book in the car. But whatever works for you, you know, Google Calendar is simple enough, you know, if that works for you as well.
Yeah. And what I would say is this, I mean, I could even see, you know, people doing this on paper and then transporting it into their online calendar, so that all you're doing is carrying your phone with you. And I could see that working as well. And then that way you're getting the double benefit of writing it and being able to retain it a little bit better, and then also having it with you no matter where you go, so that you're not forgetting anything in that regard as well.
Mm. So I was going to ask this question, but I guess I shouldn't, about different about different apps you might use, even organizationally outside of a calendar. I use one. I'll share it. It's free. It's called any.do. So any.do, but any.do. Basically just a list. It's a list of things that you put in there. It can remind you of certain things. I found it very beneficial. You can create different categories. But again, you could just use your phone or a piece of paper with a list of things. It just categorizes things a little easier. But everybody's got their own thing, whatever works for you.
Yes, everybody does have their own thing. And again, you know, in this world of dinging and binging and, you know, all of these things that go on, sometimes we tend to ignore the dings, right? So even if your calendar may be dinging you or however that is alerting you, sometimes we turn that off, right? And so we kind of, you know, it may be a good idea for you to have a backup of some sort just in case. Now, those of us who have these lovely little things on our wrists called Apple Watches, you know, I can't get away from anything, because everything comes to this. So even if for whatever reason it doesn't ding on my phone, it always dings on my watch. But, I find that people are just so inundated with technology that sometimes the older ways are the best. And like I said, you got to do what you need to do and what's best for you. But sometimes when you're in such a stressful place and you're like, I got to do something different, sometimes it's helpful to go back to basics and just say, okay, let's back this thing up for just a second. Let's go back to using paper and pencil, and let's just see how we can rework things so that it works best for me. I will probably always be a paper and pencil girl, just because that's kind of how I was taught and brought up, and that's how my brain works the best. But I certainly don't have anything against electronic stuff. But sometimes it's such a breath of fresh air to be able to just go back to basics, you know?
I don't even know how to write anymore. I have to write something down. It's like, my hand hurts. I haven't done this in so long. How about some other organizational tips or insight that you can share?
So one of the things that I learned from Franklin Covey back in the day, and if you have listeners that remember Franklin Covey is still a company, but they don't have retail stores anymore. They're a planner company, and they used to sell paper planners. You can still get them online, but certainly not to the extent that you could back in the 90s. But they did a whole bunch of training in time management. And I'm telling you, this is like one of my things. And so I kind of just soaked up everything I could from them. And Stephen Covey was the founder of that, the late Stephen Covey was the founder of that company. And he used to teach that one of the things that we forget is that our to-do lists tend to get filled up with all of those mundane things that we have to do, right? It's go to the cleaner, go buy cat food, go do this, go do that. And really the bigger picture for a to-do list is to be able to break down your goals into those manageable size tasks daily so that you can get to where you want to go. And we forget that. And what happens is we fill it up with all this other stuff and we never get to where we want to go because we forget to write that stuff down. And so again, whatever system you're using, it doesn't matter. But one of the things that I would say is that as you're considering your weekly schedule, what are those goals that you want to reach? You know, the quarterly ones, the yearly ones, however you break it down for yourself, you know, have you written those down anywhere? Paper, pencil, electronic, it doesn't matter. Have you written those down anywhere? And by the way, have you forgotten about them? We're coming up on a new year. So, you know, I don't do resolutions. I do goals. It's very different for me. In fact, I'm headed to Nashville next week to Oolapalooza, where that's our big planning conference next year, next week. And so we're going to start working on our 2023 goals next week in Nashville with about 500 or 600 of our closest friends. It's going to be so much fun. But, you know, have you considered the fact that you wrote these down and yet you're not breaking them down into bite-sized pieces, meaning daily pieces, so that you're getting to where you want to go? What happens is when you don't do that, all those mundane things start to take over and you're like, is this all there is? And that is a legitimate question for a lot of people who are under a lot of stress right now, because they're thinking, is that all this? But when you start writing those things down and accomplishing these little bitty things daily, along with buying the cat food and going to the cleaners, all of a sudden things change for you. And your stress becomes much more manageable because you can actually start to see some progress. I don't care what category of goal that you're trying to work in or try to reach. When you break it down like that and you actually add it to your organizational to-do list for the day, it becomes so much easier.
What about on that daily to-do list? Are there things that you should knock off first? Any thoughts on that?
Oh, see, here's the deal. I kind of go against the grain about most time management folks on this. You know, most people would say, you know, do the thing that you dread the most first. Mm-hmm. I do not disagree with that, but here's what works for me. And this is because I am a check off list kind of gal. I really get excited about checking stuff off my list. Like, I feel like I'm actually getting stuff done.
Yep.
What I typically do, and this may or may not be right, but you got to do what's best for you. I will go in and do the low hanging fruit first. Meaning, if I know that I can knock those things out in 5 or 10 minutes and get a whole bunch of stuff taken care of on my list, I would much rather see all those check marks and then get to the other stuff. And here's why. It gives me motivation to keep going. It kind of shows me, look what you've done. Look what you've been able to do. Now keep going. A lot of people disagree with that because they think, you know, then you're not ever going to get to the important stuff. Does that happen sometimes? Yes. But for the most part, no. It gives me the motivation and just the movement forward that people need, the momentum forward that people need to actually go and tackle those other things. So I don't know how you do it, but I actually prefer to do as much of the low-hanging fruit as possible. And I actually schedule, so I know the first part of my morning is going to be some of that stuff. So I typically don't schedule meetings or anything else until later in the day when I know that those are the big, what Franklin Covey would call the big rocks that we have to address. So that's how I do it. Again, it's pretty much, you may have a boss that dictates to you how you have to do things. I am my boss. So I say, let's get as much stuff done as we can. And then, you know, create that momentum for the day so that you're not wanting to give up. Right.
You have something to look forward to immediately, knowing that those items are going to get done. Yeah, I'm going to do that. I'm going to do that. So you know that you're going to have that feeling of accomplishment coming your way, you know, hopefully by like 10:30 in the morning, you know, if you can knock those off and now dig into the other stuff. So, yeah, I think I agree with you. You know, yeah. Why wouldn't you want to do that?
And there's going to come a point where you're not going to really have to do that much, right? Especially if you're just kind of catching up on this organizational thing, right? And you're trying to get yourself in a place where you can handle, you know, everything that's on your plate. In Ula, we talk about the Skittles and the oranges, right? Or the oranges and the Skittles, being the oranges being the big things in your life that you need to put in first. And then you put those Skittles around there. I don't disagree with that. I support that 100%. I do think there's a time in life, though, where, you know, you've got so many big things that you need to do that sometimes checking off the boxes on the little things gives you so much encouragement to be able to go and handle those big things. I think you have to be wise in your own life. And I'm not just saying you, I mean, you as a collective, you know, have to be wise in your own life and figure out what is best for you and what's going to give you the most motivation so that you can get stuff done and get that stress level decreased. That's the goal here, amongst other things, besides reaching your goals, right?
How about some of those things that we all have to do, like return phone calls or check emails? Some say first thing in the morning, check all your emails and then move on to something else. Same thing possibly for phone calls. Any thoughts?
Again, I think it depends on your energy level. I am not a morning person. I just think nothing good can happen before 10 a.m.
Okay.
That's just me. But I was even born in the afternoon, if that tells you anything. So that was set very early in life, I think. But I do think, well, and it also depends on, you know, your client, the person you have to call. If you know that person's going to be in the morning and that's the only time they're going to be in, you probably shouldn't make that phone call in the morning. But again, you just have to be very self-aware of what's happening in your life and what's going on in your schedule. If you have a meeting at 10 and that person that returns your call has your answer to what you're going to have to talk about in that meeting at 10, you probably should call them, you know, before that meeting, right? So I think there's some wisdom there in what's happening in that daily schedule. I also highly suggest that people sit down on Sunday nights or sometime on Sunday or sometime on the weekend and plan your week. Take this sheet or whatever it is that you're using and plan your week, because that will give you some peace of mind that is so wonderful that when the curveballs come your way during the week, you will already know what's happening because you have seen that sheet at least once because you've created it. And if you're one of those people that transports that into an electronic format, then you've done that a second time. So it's kind of seared in your brain, right? So when the curveballs come, you're like, oh, I can handle that, or I can't handle that, or I need to move this, or I need to take care of that, right? So I highly recommend weekend planning, even if it's a Friday afternoon before you leave the office, just whatever it means to you, actually set some intentional time. It takes 15 minutes, set a timer for 15 minutes and just plan your week ahead. And I promise you things will look so much better the next week. And then that way you're not coming in Monday morning and scrambling and wondering, do I need to make that phone call? Do I need to return that email? You know, it just makes things so much easier.
That's such a great idea. And guess what? I used to do that and forgot. Mm-hmm. So thank you for that reminder.
Yeah.
We don't go anywhere. We wouldn't drive somewhere without using GPS on our phone or in our car, or whatever it is. Why would you want to navigate your week without knowing how you're going to go and where you're going to go?
And boy, you talk about escalating stress levels. I mean, if you don't know where you're going and then life throws you those curveballs during that week, man, you are going to be in deep trouble because you have no plan to begin with. And then you have no way of mitigating those curveballs that come into your life. The one other thing I would recommend too is that you take, and this is where I would say use this sheet. Absolutely. I actually will take this sheet and create my week of utopia is what I call it. If you could have any week you wanted, if you had 100% complete control over your week, what would that look like? And I actually will create a sheet and put it up on my bulletin board across the way from me over here. And I will look at that. And when I sit down to do my weekly planning, I will try to create that week as best I can and then put in those other things around it that absolutely have to get done that week. And what that does is it creates at least the illusion that you have control over that week, right? You have control over what you say yes and no to. You don't have control over the surprises, but you have control about how much white space you leave in your week, for example, you know, how much you undercommit or overcommit on things or what you do. And so if that's what you want is to be able to have better control over that, then create that week of utopia. And then when you sit down to do your weekly schedule, just be sure you reference that so that you know how you want to direct your week. You are in complete control of that. And I think people forget that sometimes.
Well, it is so important, Melissa, to have that plan because things are going to go off plan. Yes, it's going to happen. At least you have the safety net to get back on track. Like, oh my gosh, what just happened there? I had to take 5 phone calls about some client issue. Where was I? Well, just go back to your calendar or your list.
Yes.
And I'll be honest with you, it's late in the afternoon as we're doing this. And I've got at least 3 phone calls to return that I should have done on Friday. And why haven't I done them? Because I know it could be a time suck and I don't want to do it. Yeah.
No, I get it. And, you know, this is one of the things that we talk about in my course that I've mentioned, the Women in Stress Reclaiming Your Life. And what you just mentioned is the issue of boundaries. We also talk about in this course, because if you listen, and we talk about this schedule before we talk about boundaries, because if you know what your capacity is for your week, and you have already been intentional in writing that down somewhere in the form of a weekly schedule, right? When people start to ask you to do things, then we start to talk about boundaries.
Yeah.
What are you going to say yes to? And what are you going to say no to? And I will guarantee you that saying no to things is way more powerful than saying yes, especially when it comes to your schedule and making sure that you are getting to where you want to go. No is a complete sentence. It's a
complete sentence.
So it is. And by the way, you don't owe anybody an explanation for saying no. Now, I wouldn't say it in a rude way or anything like that, but you know, just saying no is self-care. And it's a complete sentence, and it's a way that you set boundaries for yourself and that you can maintain the integrity of your schedule.
And think of this final thought. You're in a, you're dealing with a lot of stress, and just saying yes, when you know it goes against your grain, when you just, I shouldn't be saying yes. It's just, you internalize it. You might not even know you're doing it. Yeah. I could take care of that for you. And inside you're like, this is just, I don't have time. Why did I do that? And then you marinate over the yes.
Yes.
It could be, you know, if whether it's a day, three, a week, or whatever it might be, you're internalizing it. When that hard no, maybe delivered in a nice way, you're done. You released it. You move on.
Yeah, and that is violating integrity against yourself, and that is one of the worst things you can do is violate that integrity against yourself. So you got to think about those things. And you know, typically the world is not going to come crashing down if you say no to someone. It's really not.
Yeah.
It's really not. So give yourself permission to say no.
Say yes to getting a free gift, which you have to offer.
Yes, absolutely. So I have one of these ready for you. It's at drmelissaoden.com/free gift. And you can download one of these weekly routine sheets for yourself and give it a try. Just give it a try. Listen, if this isn't your cup of tea, then you do what is best for you. But I just want to provide some tools that people can use if they just don't know where to start. This would be a great place to start, in my opinion.
Yeah. And get those highlighters out, or go to Staples and pick up a pack, you know, for $5.
Yes. Or, you know, I have this pen that's got like 5 colors in it right here. So, you know, use that one. use it.
I love the color coding. My thing is, if you're going to do it right. Add the colors to it. That's because it's just going to make your life so much easier.
Yeah. It really is.
Dr. Melissa Oden, ODEN.com/free gift. We'll give it to you. And if anybody wants to even pick your brain or even work with you on reducing stress, and that's something that you do specialize in for women, you have the course, all the information, even the course. Is the course out yet? We said at the end of the month, right?
Yeah, no, well, it's supposed to be. I'm going to have to delay it a week. I've had some production issues. I'm sure you can understand. Things happen, right? If you download the free gift, you're going to be added to my email list. So you will find out when that course comes. I'm planning the week of December 5th at this point for that to be out. Yeah. Not too bad of a delay.
We just demonstrated that if you do put it in the calendar, it is subject to change, just like we said.
It is.
There you go.
It is. And listen, I'm not stressing about it. It's okay. We'll be fine.
It'll be all right.
Melissa,
always great talking with you. Happy Thanksgiving, by the way.
Happy Thanksgiving to you as well. I hope you have a wonderful day on Thursday.
Are you looking for even more of the podcasts and hosts that you love? The Podcast Business News Network is proud to announce that you now have even more ways to listen live. Check out the MyTuner Radio, Online Radio Box, and Simple Radio apps on iOS and Android, or find us online. Search for Business News Network on mytuner-radio.com, or search Podcast Business News Network on streama.com and onlineradiobox.com/US. Take your podcasts on the go and don't miss a minute of the action.
Broadcasting from the business capital of the world, this is the Podcast Business News Network.
For nearly 2,000 severely injured veterans, everyday life has become filled with barriers.
Day-to-day simple tasks can become pretty daunting.
I have to carry my chair up 2 flights of steps or have somebody do it for me.
What scares me the most is just the falling.
When I'm struggling with my house, I think, you know, to have that one great barrier just knocked down, I mean, it's crucial.
Home for Our Troops is a wonderful nonprofit that builds a
mortgage-free, fully adaptive, handicap-accessible house.
And there's no catch.
It'll be our very first home.
that we've ever owned.
This is a game changer.
This is where your life begins again.
We need you to join us in completing this important mission. Please visit hfotusa.org and help build homes and rebuild lives.
Because of you, everything's going to be okay.